while waiting for the projector. You got back your answer, and I have actually hinted some points in the chat group and tell you one of your major weaknesses. One answer that I like is Anuja's way of writing, and there's one more. This answer is that there's one of you who wrote about the solution and then used force field analysis. Whose answer is that? No one remember who wrote. There's one particular answer I remember. You mentioned about the failure, and then you mentioned about the solution, and then you write about force field analysis. Okay, that's your answer, sorry. I need one more which I saw. Can you just let me see your answer? Okay, never mind. The main issue is there are some of you actually wrote very straight to the facts. Like, I think he would have a good answer in the sense that she is a very structured answer. I wanted to share in the group one, but I said you all don't like, so I did not take any share. If you all don't mind, next time I share, if you all mind, fine, right? Okay, then next time I share, if I see anything, I see it's good. But Ewan has a very structured answer, in the sense that her answer is very guided, model according to the cultural web. So she started by telling me one paragraph, the stories, then they tell us about how he manages dealing with crisis, the routine, the control system. So first is really structured. So when you read answers like that, you can see that she has in mind some model about how she wants to present the answer. So I like the part about being very organized. This answer is very organized, okay? But I don't like the part about the answer does not go in depth to look at what is the reason why the projector doesn't seem to come out on. Early morning like that. Okay? Now, that she does not have the in-depth to look beyond what is in the case. So the answer looks very like she just copy and reorganize the point. That's a bit lacking. Whereas Anuja's has this way of writing which I kind of find is very very suitable for SBL. I just read a bit about how she writes the answer. Okay? Now, she starts by saying that based on your notes to me on iCompute, I'm able to feel the problem and the tension in the culture of your organization. So she wrote it in a style. Of course, the question didn't ask for any particular format, but I see that she take it from the point that I'm a consultant. So when I write to you, I'm communicating with you. Okay, but anyway, no marks is given on that kind of thing because there's no marks allocated on that. But she starts by saying, your description has clearly mentioned that iCompute is currently one of the top largest software in the country and is specialized in bespoke software. Now, the work hard, play hard, work ethics are still in practice and employees are expected to work long hours and to play after work. Now, this has been part of the routine, okay? So the way she writes is she's able to blend back without really telling you a heading. But she said this is part of the routine by all the members of the organization. And then she goes on and say, personally, I feel this routine is very gender biased. So that is a good way of how you present your argument to analyze the situation. So she said that I feel that you want them to work long hour, and she felt that this is very
gender bias, and it's favoring the male employees more than the female. Now, the analysis part coming when you write and present the answer in this way. Then she said, even the male members would find it hard to keep up their energy level, which has to be contributed on their activities as well. So many factors like fitness and health has to be considered. Now, no wonder the female employees with family, especially, will tend to be unhappy as they will be missing their children who need their care and time back at home. So such an activity will only demotivate the spirit of the working and, most important, being part of the organization. And these may lead to chances of losing talented females. Now, so she actually presented in a very well-communicated manner that you don't feel like this answer is a very book writing answer, but you feel very real that this person is able to see the whole picture and blend in everything and then put the answer up. Now, I think this style of writing is what we are looking towards. Okay, so if you want to have a look at the setting and put it up, you are the one who wrote the post view, because she did mention about, let me see, is it yours? No, not you. Who wrote the force? It's yours. Okay. So she even go in and talk about how to use the force field analysis. But that's a bit out of the requirement, because the questions focus more about analyze the culture and then talk about what is the impact on future performance. So solution should only come as a small part. Not like, because you wrote too long about solution. So you'd be actually wasting a lot of time and you don't get a lot of marks there. Okay, so that's my view on that. And this is stupid, right? What is happening? Why I cannot present my thing for check up? Okay, I have a feeling that maybe this... Okay, I have a feeling maybe this thing spoiled it. So I go and get one. Okay, since in that case, we change a bit of plan of what we're going to do. Now, I've given you a list of questions that you need to practice. So can we just look at this question here? Some old questions from the previous exam. Some I just want you all to go back and do it on your own. Okay? If you find that anything on the answers you don't understand, or you have other point of view and you want to check with me, feel free and we discuss about it. Okay? Now, the first question, page 1. It's a question that asks on what you mean by public interest and talks about the trend. Okay, now I need to tell you that in the answers, like questions like B1 is something that they won't ask in SBL exam because they don't focus on this kind of theory. Okay, now we look at page 3. Okay, now we talk about this thing on insider, outsider, the last class. And this is a question that they actually look into. What do you mean by insider, outsider? And then part B and part C is where they deal with ethics. So there's a short case there. Now I would like you to do this. You just spend a few minutes while I walk there and come back. You know, the journey is so long, it takes me 1 hour. Okay? So you just read this question and think of some point. I'll discuss with you, but I won't write the answers. I'll just discuss with you and see if there's anything that you don't see or you miss out the point. We'll come back and then we'll discuss this. Let me just go and get my replace adapter. Now, let's look at what they want you to do. Now, the question say, explain how a family or an insider-dominated business differs from a public listed company. Now, and you should use the evidence from the case and explore the governance issue that is associated with insider-dominated business. Now, we have not really gone through everything about the governance structure and system, but with the knowledge that you've inherited even from F8, you should be able to see differences, okay? So they want you to explain the difference. Now, you cannot explain different if you don't compare. So when you write the answer, you have to try saying that, you know, this is family and it's different because that's how listed company usually do. That's how you explain different, okay? So how you compare to a PLC, okay? All right, and then it goes on and say, Mr. Shreve is a professional accountant and an auditor. Now, it says, why is he considered a professional? You know, this is the thing that we discussed the very day when we started about professionalism. And I told you, like, why do you call accountants professional? Because of some qualities, right? Like, we have said things like by being associating with a professional body, by the needs of acquiring skills and past exam. Okay? Now, the fact that you have to continuous development, obviously, we say the lifelong learning, that even after you graduate, you still have to attend courses that's making you professional. The fact that we have a code of ethics that we comply with, that made us professional. So it's just a small thing that you have to start with, like, why do you say a professional accountant is a professional? That's what they're asking. Give me some attributes or some characteristics of being a professional. Okay, and I don't think the second question will actually be tested in SBL. I really doubt so. When they just ask you to describe the fundamental principle of professionalism that the society expects from you. I think this question is too, they call it the root learning kind of question. You study and remember, I doubt so much. Okay? It got 10 bonus. But anyway, in these questions, the fundamental principles, you talk about five, right? You must be very good, right? Which five? The COEIP, right? The COP is police, the confidentiality, objectivity, professional competence, integrity, professional behavior. Now, so I'm going to qualify that question. I don't think it will be suit for SBL. Now, C is something that I would think it's some SBL requirement, SBL standard, that you actually need to go in to evaluate. Discuss the professional and the ethical dilemma that Shreve is facing when he decides whether or not to tell Ken and Steffi about Ivan's activity. Make it real that, you know, it is a real situation. Why do you find it difficult? And follow Anuja's answer. Release it from your heart. Make it very real that, you know, if this is my situation, That's what I'm facing. That's my problem. So try not to write a very theoretical answer. But if you can feel the situation, you are able to produce a point, okay? Now, and then advise him what is the most appropriate course of action. Now, that's the two requirements that we're going to focus at. The first one is about the insider-outsider. Then we talk about the dilemma, the conflict, or you want to say the conflict,
the competing demand,
and then it says that what is the most appropriate course of action, the most appropriate course. Now, because it's most appropriate, it has to be something that we regard it as the right action. Okay, now let's read the case. As I say, I'm not going to write all the answers, but I'm giving you the point answers at the back. Okay, now some of the points I say beyond the back as well. Happy and healthy, it's a traditional independent health food business that has been run as a family company for 40 years by Ken and Steffi Porter. Now, as a couple, they have always been passionate campaigners for healthy food, and they're more concerned about the quality of the foods they sell than the financial detail of their business. Now, just these three lines itself, we already start seeing the differences when a company is insider and outsider based. Number one, what do you see? The shareholding characteristics. A company that is owned by family members, and looking at this statement, maybe it's between the husband and the wife. When if you look at a listed company, it's definitely not like that. A listed company will have a lot more shareholder where they have very little shareholding. That's the definition in fact. The definition of insider outsider is that is the dispersed ownership that we see in the outsider-based system and the concentrated ownership in the insider-based system. That's one point. Okay, I hope you pick it up. Alright? That's one point. So the ownership characteristics. Now, and then, you know, it says that to them, they are more concerned with the quality than the financial details. You can do that because, alright? You can do that because. Now, you see, when I say look at the point and adopt and then go deeper, is you must use your own words to evaluate why is that so. Now, why that if you are insider-based company, you can do this? That you say you are more concerned with quality and not so much with financial detail. But if you are not insider-based, but you are outsider-based, you can't. What's the difference? It's the accountability to shareholder. Now, that becomes the point that you go deep. You know, when you start writing and say, you know, the main difference that why happy and healthy can do that is because they are not accountable to outside shareholder when they themselves are the shareholder. Make sense? That when outsider-based company, you're accountable to outside shareholder, where if you are not able to deliver expectation, what will happen? Well, shareholders might kick you out. So I'm there for my job. I don't do the work, shareholders say that's it. Game over, you're out. See that? So the fact that because the shareholders would demand, because the fact that shareholders would come in and say that no, this is not what we want, you don't have a choice. Now when you write like that, that's what I mean by go deep and write something not here. Rather than you just copy the same sentence and tell me, you know, you have that tendency of writing answer in that way, which is not what we want. We are not asking for a robot. We are asking for someone that can
think and write.
Okay, so pick up that skill, very important. Now, so I've given you the second point, okay? So take note. Accountability to shareholder, where shareholders can actually remove directors
if you don't perform. You can write something like that. Okay, and then go on. Alright? Since the company started in 1970,
it has been audited by Watson Shreef, a local audit firm. And that's like 40 years, right? 40 years.
The same auditor, 40 years. Do you see this often if it's a listed company? No. Now, this is the governance aspects. That it's all right
for happy and healthy because these companies just belong to two of them. They don't complain and then that's fine. But in a public listed company, what we need is assurance.
We needed confidence. We needed auditors to be objective and independent. Well, so shareholder is more likely to object the fact
that the auditor has remained unchanged for so many years. Now, I think that's going to be like a third point. The same auditor for the last 40 years.
It's harder for a listed company to do that because they needed objectivity.
Alright, so the key point is objectivity. Now, and then if you read on, they say that Shreef has overseen the Potter's audit for all the 40-year history. Of course, they put there rotating the partner. I think the examiner just want to
write something so that, you know, when people say, how can? So that's why the examiner want to add, and you know, they still rotate the partner. But really, even if you don't rotate the partner, you still can do that. Because rotation is only a requirement if you're listed. Think and see. If you're not listed, even if you don't rotate, there's nothing wrong about that. You can do that, alright? Now, and has always taken opportunity to meet with Ken and Steffi informally at the end of the audit to sign off the financial statement and offer a briefing and some free financial advice in his role as what he called auditor friend. Now, you see, over the years, right, because the auditor has always been there, they have built a very close relationship with the owner manager. The owner manager. They are the owner, they are the manager, they are the directors, right? Now, and you can understand why things like that is very common when the company is small. Because a lot of times, small companies, they don't have people with the right skill, knowledge, so they really needed the advice of the consultant. That's why a lot of audit firms are really like that. They teach their client things that they need to know. Alright? So over the years, they build a close relationship. But you don't see things like that when the company is listed because somehow the auditor know that they need to keep a distance. Plus number two, a lot of big listed companies, because they can afford to hire their own people, they don't really need your advice. They got their own people and they always feel like we're even better than our auditor. Why do we need to listen to you? So this made a difference here. So the role of the auditor is seen very differently. Number four, the role of the auditor and the relationship that the auditor built. Now I will put this in the fourth point. So there's lots of differences, right, you see? Now, and it goes on. In this briefing, Shreef, who has become a close family friend of the Potters over the year, always points out that the business is profitable, which the Potters already knew, without the actual figures. Now, how they might increase their margin? But Potters have never been too concerned about financial performance as long as they can provide a good service to their customers. So again, it's back to objective of doing business. So this is back to point number two. So I don't repeat, it's point number two, is the objective of doing business.
All right, now then it goes on and says, while can and, sorry, as long as they can provide a good service and make enough to keep business going and continue employment for themselves and their son Ivan. Now, while Ken and Steffi still retain a majority shareholding in Happy and Healthy, they have gradually increased Ivan's proportion over the year, and currently they have 60% and Ivan 40%. Now, again, now they clearly tell you the shareholding proportion, which repeat point one. They only have three shareholders. Okay? Now, Ivan was appointed as director alongside with Ken and Steffi in 2008. Now, do you see the thing here that's very different compared with the listed company? Two words, if you're going to describe this process, start with S. S-P. What word is that?
The way that they say that they appoint Ivan as a director and they want him to be happy and they want to keep him in the company. What is the SP? Anyone had that word? Setapak kucung. The last word is planning. Yeah? Yeah, it's succession planning. You know, this is an issue of succession planning, which is a very important issue in any organization. To appoint people to carry on what you want them to do. Succession planning. And all the small companies that usually their family own, they always put their own children on. They always say, oh, my father business must pass to the son. I'm a prime minister. I want my son to be prime minister. That's always our problem. You see, because you have that mindset that you always want to make your own people to be there, you corrupt the system. Because you want to make the system to have the foundation to allow your way of doing things. That's why things become very important. Okay? Now, come back to this. So Ivan grew up in the business and has helped his parents. And since he was a young boy, as he grew up, Ken and Steffi gave him more and more responsibility in the hope that he would one day take the business over. By the end of 2009, Ken made sure Ivan drew more salary than Ken and Steffi combined as they sought to ensure that he's happy to continue in the business. What is the issues that we are seeing now?
Or ask yourself, if this company is not publicly listed, do you still see the same thing? Then what do you see? If you don't see this, then what do you see? What do you see? Sorry? Yeah, in what way? How will it be different? What you're seeing now is the parents say that I want to make sure my son is happy, so I'm going to give him more pay. I'll give whatever you want. So if this is not a family business, how do you see? What anak manja, I'm not asking you to tell me about the son. I'm saying if this company is not family owned, if it's a public listed company, what would you do? Will you do the same thing? You say no, right? Okay, if you say no, then what would you do? What will you do, AG? This is your shareholder. Will you just give whatever you want to a man? Just to say, I want you to be happy. Huh? Okay, and what justify the salary? The what?
Performance, exactly.
You know, when you come to a business world, we don't talk about, you know, I'm close with you, I give you more. It's the numbers that count. show me the results and I give you. Okay, give me profits, you get more. Can't perform, you get less. Sorry, there's no such thing as I want you to be happy. I need performance. So this is going to be very, very different. So of course, you're going to touch on the point that, yeah, the remuneration system is so different because it's a game driven by your personal objective. But you must compare it. You must compare that, you know, if the company is listed, the shareholders will not want that. That's why this Sapura Energy, Sapura Energy is very active, okay? To research the company. Now, Sapura Energy's CEO draws 66 million salary a year. But the company lose money like men. Or in a more words, losing money like shit. And shareholders are questioning, hello, you're not even making profit and you take so high package, how can that be? And EPF went to the AGM and objected. And EPF voted against it. Of course, EPF lost because EPF only got 5% share. It can't do much. But the fact that EPF was there to even object it is a very strong signal. And tell you, hello, you see, we care about all that. So you don't back up, next thing will come. That's why when you see the election, the signals were there. And we keep giving government more and more time, but they didn't do anything. So eventually there'll be a point that everything will be done. Okay? Now then it says that during the audit for 31st March 2010, the member of Watson Street was performing the audit as usual. And then he noticed a dramatic drop in the profitability of the business as a whole. He noticed that while food sales continue to be profitable, a large amount of inventory had been sold below cost. So, and that's funny. Why are you selling below cost? And to a company called Barong. With no further explanation, and it was this that caused the reduction in the margin. I mean, everything else is okay, but because of this problem, overall margin is wrong. That every transaction with Barong had the invoices shown authorized by the group. Now, Sri was certain that Ken and Steffi would not know anything about this, and he's prepared to tell them as part of his annual end of audit meeting. And before the meeting, he carried out some checks on Barong and found that it was a separate business owned by Ivan and his wife. The Shreve conclusion was that Ivan was effectively stealing from Happy and Shreve. Now, there's a fraud going on. Ivan stealing from this company by using the parent's company, sell back to his own company at very cheap price. So he's able then to sell it again and make some profit with that. Now, although Shreve now has recommended certain disclosures to the financial statements in this meeting, his main fear was that Ken and Steffi would be devastated if they found out that Ivan was stealing and that it would have a long-term implication for the family relationship and the future of the company. Now, one last thing. Just one last paragraph. How do you see things be different if this is insider base compared with this company? Well, it's not there, it's not mentioned, but you can just think about that. How do you think that things would be different if you're looking at the last paragraph? Right? Auditor view for the family, okay. Okay, I accept that, but I'm not looking at the auditor's feeling. I'm looking at something more concrete. Something that the actions be really different. Legal action, right? Okay, like what? Like what? A bit. I want to see what is your thought. If it's a company that owned by this family member, what will they do? Yeah, you probably just overlook. I mean, my son is stealing. I mean, what do you expect me to do? He's
your son stealing, chop his hand off. Huh? What are you going to do? Probably you can't sleep at night. Can't sleep at night. Turn to your wife and say, wow, my son. Kick sim, yeah, kick sim. You write that. Kick sim, alright? Okay? So, you feel heart pain because of what you're going through. If it's a listed company, what will you do? Huh? Sad, right? If you take action, right? As you heard, look at our ex-prime minister. If the father is alive, probably the father will kick him. Is it not? Kick him because he is so stupid. People still, nobody knows. You still, the whole world knows. Is it not? So not because he's stealing. The father won't kick him because he's stealing. The father kicks him because he's stupid. Steal until people know. That's stupid. Yeah, can see it not? Okay? Now, so you see, the thing that will be very different, point number 7. You see, there's so many points there, right? It's the way how you handle, how to handle these kind of problems like fraud. Okay, so if a listed company, I think you're gonna sack him, you're gonna take action against him, you might make a police report. Things are going to be very strict, okay? But because it's a family-owned company, chances is they're just going to overlook this and nothing is going to happen, alright? It's very, very normal, okay? I know of listed companies that father-son and then son make mistake, company lose multi-million as a result of the mistake. But the father can then so, but at the end of the day, he's still my son, alright? The rich man is always different. When they're rich, they make more expensive mistakes. We make less expensive mistakes, okay? Now, that's part A, okay? Okay. What is the reason why his professional, I've told you the attributes, right? Just quote a few examples, like, you know, he's a professional because he has to be a member of a professional body. And then he's a professional because he need to go through an extensive education, study and pass exam. He's expected to comply with the code. Okay, now, so I just list down, membership, you gotta pass exam, you gotta comply with a code. Okay, you have a duty for the public. Now, these will be some of those points that you need. Okay, can I go to the last part and look at the professional and ethical dilemma? They have given you what you are supposed to do is whether or not to tell Ken and Steffi about Ivan's activity. Now, it can only be a dilemma because it will always result in conflicting choices. That means one side of you say, you gotta tell. One side of you say, no, maybe we shouldn't tell, okay? Now, so the conflict must always be one side saying, we need to tell. The other side is, no, we don't tell. So which side of you that says you need to tell? The professional side or the personal side? Professional side, right? Okay? Now, professionally, you need to tell. Why that professionally you have to tell? If you say it's a professional requirement, then there must be something that is there that tell you have to tell. What is it that says you have to tell? Example? Auditing standards? Would auditing standards require you some kind of disclosure? You have to what? You know, when you do audit, I'm going to quote you a few audience sentences you probably won't remember. ISA 265 is communication with those charged with governance. 265 is communicating weaknesses in internal control. 240 is fraud. You know, these are all the standards that say that whenever you have problem, you have a duty to inform the board of directors. You must help. It's a professional requirement. You see or not?
So you just look at, now I don't need you to quote the standard, but you just look at the auditing standard. It's obviously expected that you need to inform the board about the weaknesses, about the fraud. Now, even when you look at the accounting standard, okay, even when you look at the accounting standard, you also notice that the accounting standard would need you to make some kind of disclosure. What kind of disclosures do we need to make? If you're looking at accounting standard, I'm talking about accounts now. Accounts. At least accounting standard, which accounting standard? I don't need a number, I just need to know which part of the accounts that says that you must say something. Rebecca, why are you every time morning I ask questions? Yeah, it's a related party transaction. This is where accounting standard says that when you have a related party transaction, and the related party is the fact that you have common director, the son is a director, the son is also there, you have to make disclosure. You cannot hide this in the account. So you see, these are all professional requirements. So the question now is, when you have all these professional requirements, what do? You must address the issue. You got to tell. Can you see that? You got to tell. Now, even if you want to talk about a bit more out from this public interest, you owe a duty to report the truth to the user. So when the shareholders are supposed to receive your accounts and the auditors report, the shareholder has a right to know the truth, and you are not telling the truth. So if you are not telling, you fail your duty professionally. That's professional. Now you must write all that to show that, you know, that's a professional requirement. Now what is the ethical part? Now the ethical part, you have to start looking at the personal part. You don't mix the professional with the ethical now, because if you mix it together, you don't know what to argue with it. But you have to look at now the personal part, the personal values.
Says otherwise.
Which way that the personal values say otherwise? What made it difficult actually for Mr. Shri is they are what?
Friend, exactly. If you are not my friend, you know, I really don't think anything so hard for me, right? You think anything, if you're not my friend, and I come across this problem, I'll just probably go and tell him, sorry, you know your son is so naughty. Don't concentrate, don't do homework, blah blah blah. I don't mind telling all these things to you, because I just want you to know the facts. Well, but if this is your such a close friend, and you know that when you start saying all that, your friend will not like it, and then that's make things difficult.
The relationship. So here, the relationship, that because they are close and they are personal. That's why they mention he has a fear that Ken and Steffi will be devastated, and he is concerned that how this will even affect their family relationship.
You even think for them and say, hey, how will this affect their family relationship? Alright? So that's the problem. Personal. You're getting personal.
That's why he's not sure what to do. Okay, so finally, you are supposed to give him an advice on what is the most appropriate course of action. Now, I think this is not hard, right? Tell or don't tell?
Tell or don't tell? Tell. Why? three, I ask you, tell, don't tell, they tell. Why? Why do you need a step? What's the reason? The duty as a professional to the profession is above all duty. That's a simple reason. That's because you carry a duty as an accountant. You're not accountant, you're not auditor, I'm fine. But because you're accountant, you're auditor, there's a duty that you carry. And that duty is above any other duty. Above any personal relationship. That's your answer. Write that, okay? Yes, you have to tell. Because as a professional, you have an obligation to serve the profession's interest above any other interest. So write that. Okay?
Alright, so that's one example that I would like you to see that touch about what we discussed last week. Okay, the rest you can go back and do lah, go back and do. And then if you look at page 6, right? Page 6, it's questions that touch on rules and principle. Okay, rules and principle. And then when you read the requirement, I just want to highlight to you. Do you see that when they ask you to do a critical evaluation? A critical evaluation is supposed to do what? Remember, I explained this to you when we first started the class. There are a couple of requirements that you're supposed to know in SBL. And then when they ask you to do a critical evaluation, they're expecting what? Argument from both sides. So when they say critically evaluate, that all the stakeholders should apply flexibly to the varying circumstances of the company. So if you ask me to say that, now I didn't read the question, but I more or less can expect that I'm supposed to say why is this statement acceptable, but at the same time, why it is wrong. See, I'm talking about why that is acceptable and why it is wrong. Okay, that's a critical evaluation. Now, then this part B, it's the one that we just finished the last class about, actually we have not finished, the separation of chairman and CEO. The code tells us you must do that. And the objective is because of what? To prevent one person having unfettered powers of decision. Okay? Now, you can do that as well. And then you see in the last page 9, that's the last questions I gave you.
Parker. Okay? We studied about Parker, right? Remember the 5 questions? Is it profitable? So far, okay, profitable, fair, right, legal, okay, sustainable or environmental friendly or environmental sustainable and legal. Alright? Now, so you're supposed to use these questions to evaluate the choice of the rule, okay? And then part C, right? It's something on stakeholder, and stakeholder is what we just covered the last class. Okay. Now, remember what is stakeholder claim? What is a claim? If you say, I just brought you through these words, so I'm not sure you remember. What's a claim? What do you mean by claim? If I claim something from you, it means what? Sorry, is it right? But let me. What does it mean when I say I want to claim something from you? That means I want to what? You give me a different word to replace the word claim. I want to claim something from you, or I want to what? A different word for claim. English class, hello. I want to claim 50 ringgit from you. I want to demand, yeah. I can demand, I can ask, I can request. So what is a claim? A demand, a request, okay? And what is a stakeholder thing? Request from stakeholder. You know, you see the word, you can understand how it's English. So it's a demand from the stakeholder.
So you actually need to identify the demand. Alright? What they demand. And then they ask you to critically assess the claim. That means your assessment here is your quantification. Your analysis of whether you find is the claim important or not important, significant or not. Alright? So how you assess? Now one way of assessing stakeholder, you think about this, okay? How do you assess stakeholder? Give me something that you learn to assess your stakeholder. Okay, how do you do that? Yeah, you mentioned Mandilo, okay fine. How do you do that? Let me, what you gonna do? Yeah, you must look at a stakeholder and then you start telling me how high, how low the interest of the stakeholder is. And how? What's the other one? Powerful. That's assessment. See that? See, you learn is one thing, but apply what you learn is another thing. You must know that, okay, the question of stakeholder, assessing stakeholder. Remember when we ask you the questions on the iComping, when they ask you to assess culture, right? And you use the model. So I ask you to assess stakeholder, you can use the model because you learn that there is a model about stakeholder, okay? Alright, so go back and try. Okay, let's move back to chairman. Okay, so the last class we said Now we say that as a chairman, you are very important figure for corporate governance. You are the defender of governance. You are the one that is there to protect shareholder. You're the main guy. And what do you do to have all that in mind? The first thing is we say you actually lead the board. And when we talk about leading the board, we highlighted something about how you build the culture, how you set the tone at the top. And then we even talk about how you might actually need to make a choice about what kind of board structure. But as I said, not all the time, because sometimes you don't have a choice. You might be in a country where the choice has been set by the law or the choice has been set by the regulation. Like Malaysia, you say, I want to go for a two-tier board, cannot. Because we don't have the framework for that. Malaysia, all directors are appointed by shareholder. Our board is unitary. You don't have a choice, because you're not okay? So please understand that it's not always something you can do. Okay, number two, we need chairman to set agenda. Now we know what's agenda, right? Before you come for a meeting, there's always a list of agenda, right? Now, but think about this. Why do you want the chairman to do it? And if chairman is not doing it, what is an example that is a bad governance? Now you must know the bad thing to see why this is the right thing. Okay? Now think about that. What is wrong if you don't have chairman to do it? Now, a good example is to see the opposite. The chairman is representing the NED, right? So the right opposite is the CEO. Now, so what is wrong is you say CEO to set agenda. That's the wrong thing. So if CEO set agenda compared with chairman set agenda, how do you see the interest of the shareholder be affected? So is it crucial or not setting agenda? Why is it crucial? What's so crucial about setting agenda? Can avoid what? Yeah. See, agenda is the things that you bring it up in the meeting. And if it's not in the agenda, technically you cannot discuss. We're talking about protocols, the process. That's why you see, those days when Barisan is still in the government, we always had problem with the speaker. Speaker is the chairman. If you always now see the parliament video that people share, you will see there's one guy sitting in the center with a song kong, that's the speaker. What is the role of the speaker? The role of the speaker is to allow things to be brought up into the meeting. So if you don't allow, you cannot even discuss anything. Then you insist you want to talk, he chase you out. He has the power, man. You don't follow protocols. You don't follow procedure. That's why if you start saying all the nonsense, you say, okay, this is not our time, you cannot speak, you insist, get out. He can set you out, he can ban you from the parliament meeting for X number of times. Now that's his power. That's why those days, every time when the opposition want to talk about one MDB, right? It was never discussed. Why? The speaker say we don't want to talk about that. Now obviously the speaker is corrupted guy. Because he must have taken the order of the CEO. Who is the CEO? The Prime Minister, you apply this, the Prime Minister tell him, nah, I don't want to talk about that. So he said, okay, I'll take your order. So every time when anyone passed a motion, he said, this one, not important, put aside. See how important is that? So imagine if I want to bring up an issue, concerns, fraud in the company. If the CEO is there setting agenda, CEO look at it, no, this is not important. We don't discuss. See? You bypassed it. So take note of that. Setting agenda is very important because you decide what comes in and what don't come in. Now that's one thing, problem. Number two, you must understand that not everything should be discussed at the board level. Now go back to the earlier things that we studied. Here. A formal schedule of matters that you reserve it to the board and you allocate to the management. Think about that. Why do you say that? Because if you keep bringing things that is not meant for us but is more for the management, you're wasting our time. You know, we don't come for meeting all the time, and every time we come for meeting, you go and use our time for all the petty things, that all the important things we bypass. So that's an important issue. So it's important that you must know our time is so limited that we only talk about important things. So the chairman has to decide. Important or not, this one. Okay? Not important, take it away. Tell the CEO, no, this one, y'all can resolve it at management level. Now, and you see, it also says that make sure there's adequate time for discussion of the item. Some items can be more contentious. Some items are more judgmental. Some items are more complex. So if you're going to call a meeting where you have five very complicated matters, what time are you going to start the meeting? Do you have enough time or not? You don't have enough time, what you're going to do? You're going to rush through. That's why you see, in practice, I'm talking about real life. In practice, when you have a lot of nasty company, when I say nasty, means these are really very bad management and very bad CEO. What they normally do is, now let's say Bursa Malaysia specify that the last day for you to announce your account, let's say the last day is the Friday of the last week, and let's say the Friday of the last week fell on 30th July, that's the last day. Now, so usually what happened is companies will have to make sure that this is the last day, everything must be out. And before things out, you need the board of directors to come and discuss and approve it. So what are the strategy of a nasty people? They call for a meeting on the last day. Now, they put the meeting on 30th July. They say meeting start at 12 noon.
Then they purposely come in. So you waited. When they come, they don't talk about business first. They start talking about politics. They start talking about what ministers say. Then they crack some stupid joke. They drag the time. 12 noon supposed to start. They start at 1:30. Then they say, let's have some food. See, they use all this as a dirty strategy. Then by the time they come to real business,
it's already 4 p.m.
Oh, we can start looking at the accounts. So if they start looking at the accounts, then they say, hey, we must have everything announced before 6 p.m. You wait on time? So they rush through. And I'm talking about very practical strategy that people are doing in real life. They always rush through. So when they rush through, they cannot check. They don't have a chance to check. They don't have a chance to ask the questions.
So most of the independent directors will what? Accept. Oh, okay lah, accept. You don't have a time one because delaying has a lot of implication. They cannot delay, so they rush through. Now, this is the strategy. Now, if you are a good chairman,
you will stand firm on this thing. You say that, no, 30th is the last day. If there's going to be an issue, where are we going to have time? You insist. We must have a meeting on the 27th. But no, not really. I don't care. That's your problem. 27. I'm the chairman. I make the call. I decide. I rule. I have the leadership responsibility.
I don't think the 27. So the management got to rush. So 27, you come for a meeting. If there's a problem, we still have 28. 29. We still have 30th. I still got 3 days. See the difference?
So ask, why is it so important?
That's the reason why it's so important. Because you have rooms to do things. Don't let the CEO manipulate and hide all the problem. So it's a simple thing, but it's very important. See that? Okay, go down. Now they say that chairman has to facilitate the contribution of NED.
What do you understand from this statement? Sleepy, I get a chance that you talk, then you won't fall sleepy. What do you mean by facilitate contribution of NED? Okay, make sure NED contribute. Excellent, right? I mean, yeah, literally that's what it means. NED contribute. How do you contribute as NED? Review? Somehow? You don't involve in the day-to-day operation as NED, right? So how do you contribute? You review the accounts, you review the documents. Only review. Review is read, you know. Review is whatever people give, you view again. It's called review. After review, must do what? Question. Now, you cannot ask question when you do not know anything. Whatever I say today, you don't even know whether I'm saying it right or wrong because you don't pretend. But that's because you're in a class, you understand that, alright? So you're supposed to be here to receive from me. But if you think and see, you are supposed to be a guard, security guard for the shareholder. You must do your homework, right? You don't do your homework, you go there, you sit down, what are you going to do? If you have opportunity, but I don't think you're going to have. If you have opportunity to follow me to, example, ACCA examiners review meeting. You see, all the lectures sit down there. Don't ask questions. Sit there. And even the culture is so bad that the examiner don't allow lecturer to ask questions on the spot. You know why? Examiners get the lecturer ask questions, they don't know how to answer. This is a very bad attitude, you know. So, but what can I say? Okay.
So we feel bad, we feel sad, but I have a lot of problem. So they don't even allow. If you ask, I remember got once I went and asked question, the examiner scolded me. Why do you ask question now only? You should send me the question much earlier, right? I said, oh yeah, I'm supposed to send, but because I was away and then now, but actually it's because I spotted it that time that I want to raise it. So she was very angry with me. Just call me. Next time, don't do like that. So next time, I don't ask her to sit down and quiet. Alright? Culture, see culture. Alright? Now,
so you see things like that is, if you go and see the meeting, everyone sit there quiet, no one participate. Right? Why? No one prepare. Right? You don't prepare, right? You cannot join the discussion.
That's the problem. So how many of the directors, when we send them their account, they actually run through the account? A lot of directors don't do the work. They just see that. That's why a lot of people see independent director as what easy money go into the pocket. Very easy, right? If you want to be an independent director, I just tell, okay, I bring you to a company, you become one, they promise you 1 year, give you 15K. What you do? Every time they're meeting, you go there, you sit, you smile me. Then you go home. After 1 year, 50,000, go into your account. Easy or not? Easy money. But if you do like that, your conscience. You're supposed to do your job now. That is contribution. So if the entity like that, as a chairman, what do you do? Can you see someone that they contribute and they don't contribute? Can see, right? You can see, right? So if you're a chairman, how do you solve this problem? I'm training you to be a chairman. Chairman 1 year can get 200,000 big company. So be a good chairman. How? One, make sure management send out all the information early. Don't give us last minute. One reason that we can't prepare is because it's last minute. Okay? How do you expect people to go all the time? So, if the meeting fell on the 27th, ensure that on the maybe 20th, you have a job. Call up the relevant people. Tell the ComSec, hey, remind them, get everything out. At least you get a reminder call. Then on the 22nd, you didn't get anything, insist. I don't care, by tomorrow must be out because we need to give time for the NED to go through. Now you see, I'm doing work. If you don't do work, you leave it, don't nobody care, then you're gonna have a problem that on that day, everybody all blank. Okay, on the day of the meeting, I'm gonna do this. The meeting starts at 11. Let us meet among the NED, just the NED. Let us meet at 10 o'clock. The ED all don't have to come in. So now the NED, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'm going to do my job. Can you run through all the things I said? Run through. Okay. Tell me what you do. Tell me what's the problem. Do you see this part? Why are you not doing work? Share the pay money. You just take the money like that. You think it's fair enough? See, I can do all that. Now, once I do all that, then the rest of the entity group, this chairman is very different. And next time you come for a meeting, you dare to be like that. You must do your work. That's your job. So when the coach says, make sure that you facilitate entity contribute. That's what you do. You do something so that you know that they are there. Not here like a vase. Sit there, show face. We don't want that. Okay? Now, that's one. Okay, what about constructive relation between ED and ED? Now, this is something very subjective. This is about managing people. It's about managing relationship. Because sometimes we can feel tension. Okay, example, we can see tension between the ED and the ND. Especially when the ND are not in very friendly tone. Like you come in and you're here, like you always carry that kind of mindset that, you know, the ED are all doing the bad things and we're here to check them. You know, that kind of tone is not. That's why a lot of people don't like to be questioned. Even I admit myself, sometimes when people start questioning me a bit more, I feel frustrated and say that, you don't trust me, man? Why you ask so many things? But over the years, I start to learn that it's not that people don't trust you, but it's that this is part of how you show them their accountability. So they want to know. So you tell them, alright? So it's not about trust or not trust. It's about part of the work. Now, so you must know how to maintain the relationship between them. So you got to spot and see, like, hey, something is going on between these two groups. and it seems like they are not so happy. And what can you do so that they will actually tone down, not so hostile? It's managing people, all right? Now, number five, you have a duty to make sure that all the diagnosis receive accurate, timely, and clear information. Now, I always say ACT, A-C-T. A-C-T. Accurate, clear, timely. So how do you do that? You coordinate. Your job is to coordinate. Like, say just now, on the 20th, I call up the ComSec to remind them, you know, the meeting is coming, so get ready all the information. And if you think that there is anything you need extra, now, you know, there's a lot of things that chairman can do. Example, they summon management staff. You know, in the board meeting, usually it's only the directors, right? But you can call the management staff. For example, we're going to discuss about performance of a subsea. And I look at the result of the subsea, I feel like there's a lot of red flags. So I insist that during the meeting, please make arrangement for whoever who is running the subsea to be there. I want to question them. So you call them. See, you can do that.
That is how you make sure directors get their information. So I just write down some example. You summon management staff.
I realize I don't write, you all don't write, I'm not very scary. So later I say so many things, I don't know how much you take back. Oh, it's the time.
You can summon management staff to be in the board meeting and question them. Now, you can allow the NED to engage external consultant. Engaging external consultants, which is part of getting information.
Okay, especially when you have any major decision, right? Like whether you want to buy a business, whether you think the deal is good, get consultants to advise. Okay,
the last thing it says here is chairman, it's the one that makes sure that there is effective communication with the shareholder. How do you have an effective communication to shareholder? Now let's think about this. Imagine, how do you communicate with shareholder? What is the mode of communication? Where do you do that? Okay, AGM. Now, I think I've asked this before, right? If you do it in AGM, that means you're able to tell people that actually attend. What about those who never attend? Send them what? The report. So, the most formal way of communicating is not just the AGM, but it's the annual report. So you see that? So annual report.
It's how you communicate. And what is the chairman's involvement in the annual report? They do what? What would the chairman do? Is there anything that the chairman actually contribute in annual report? Where would they leave their comments? Note section, which section? All notes in the annual report. There's one very particular section. What do you call that particular section? Where the chairman writes whatever he wants to write.
It's called chairman statement. You don't believe me, Oh, love. I show you annual report. The starting of the annual report is called chairman statement. Alright? Now, so there will be a chairman statement. I don't have the new one, but I have one very old annual report here. Now, do you see
page 6, 7, 8, 9, 4 pages of writing by the chairman? Who's supposed to write that? Theoretically, it's the chairman.
But in practice, is it the chairman who writes all that, or it really depends? Some good companies, the chairman do his work, the chairman can write. Some company, hopeless one, they don't write one. They just get a comsec to put out some word and then get the auditor to give some idea and then they publish. So that's really useless. So that's why governance has failed miserably in this company. Now, a very good example is, go Google. Warren Buffett letters. Just Google this, Warren Buffett letters. Warren Buffett letters.
It's so famous that this has been something iconic. Something that, you know, people associate it with him. Every year, he writes letters to his shareholder. Long letter. And in the letter, he shared his emotion, his feeling, what he see, what he felt, what he did, everything he will write that. And all investors are so forward-looking and waiting for the letter because they can see everything he want to tell them. And it's not like 1-2 pages, and it's very, very long. He really write, every year he write that.
And this is part, this is like chairman's statement, but he made it in his own way. He write letters and show that this is what I want to tell you. And that has been part of how you communicate with shareholder. Now, so chairman statement is one, and then of course AGM is one. All right.
Now, you know, in exam they might ask you like, why is chairman statement so important? That's because it's supposed to be something that you write. You know, when you write, you are able to say what you want to say. Then, you know, you have some power for being able to say things. That's why you see in politics, right? You know how they control politics? They control the way you communicate. Look at North Korea. They ban all the TV. Alright? They ban all the TV. Look at China. China is still the same. They ban everything there. That's why no Facebook, no Google. You know, even in China, churches are being so tightly controlled that the one that people see out there, the churches out there are all controlled by the government. Even the Bible also have their own version because the government read through and say, okay, a certain thing I don't want. Like that one. Then they want to preach also and say, there are certain things you cannot say one. See, they control information. Why do they control? Because information make you smart. No? That's why once you allow information to go freely, that's the reason why government lose. Because of the WhatsApp, the viral, the Facebook, and those days Mahathir is so strong because when he's as a prime minister, there's no information. Everybody is only through mainstream media. So it's the control of information. Think about that, it's very, very important. Ability to say things. So that when you can say, you have the power. Because people scared. Understand? So chairman's statement is very important.
Now, let's look at what the court tells us in terms of the provision. What do you do? Okay, it says that chairman, when you appoint them, you have to meet the independence criteria. Now, so we know that a chairman must be independent entity. Right guys, can I stress on this? NED has to be independent, but not all NED is independent. Alright? So chairman has to be independent, but not all NED is independent. That's why whenever we see NED, right, you gotta understand that you can have independent NED. You can have a non-independent NED.
Now, of course, ED for sure is non-independent, for sure.
So NED can be independent or not independent. But for example, if the CEO, and the brother to the CEO is the NED, you are not independent. So you got to be independent. So now we always ask, how do you tell if a director is independent or not independent? Do you have like a benchmark or a set of rules for us to see? That's why the code came out with a list of criteria. So this is the criteria that we're going to see. So later on in B1.1, the criteria of why you regard director as independent. I'll come to that later, okay? Now, then let's read the next line. A CEO should not go on to be the chairman of the company. What does it mean? What do you understand from this line? A CEO should not go on to be the chairman of the company. Hello? What does it mean? Now, cannot be the same person. Is that what it means? That means if you're a CEO, you cannot be a chairman. Is that what it means? No, that's not what it means. You cannot be the same person has already been said here. Eh? The role of a chairman and the CEO cannot be the same person. That's already said. So this is not about being a same person. This is about what? Yeah, Rebecca, about what? Yeah, after being a CEO, that's what it means. After you being a CEO, you should not become a chairman. That means you shouldn't retire and become a chairman. Look at Malaysia, all these examples, a lot of banks are there. CIMB, Mr. Nazir Razak was the CEO, retired, become chairman. Public Bank also like that. Teong Piao, Tan Sri Teong Piao was the CEO and now become the chairman. Of course, he's so old, that's why he announced his retirement. This year, he's going to step down. Alright? Now, so why that the code say no? Must be a reason, right? Think about that. They say that if you've been the CEO, you should not go on. That means you retire as a CEO and become a chairman. You should not. Now, why retired CEO should not be the chairman? You know, when we study the code, we only know the code say this, don't do that, don't do. But when we learn in the class, we should learn the spirit. And that's the purpose why we want you to learn all that. Because you start to see that all, that's the problem. And that's why you appreciate the rule. What is the reason that why a retired CEO should not be chairman? Let's come up with 4 or 5 points. Okay, and good. One, you're not independent. You know, and by not being independent, there's already a few points that you're going to violate. First, you will not comply with the code. The code has made it very clear, right, that you got to be independent, but now you can't, okay, so you will not be able to comply with the code. What else? Now, by not being independent, it also create a lot of problem because of what? Your previous relationship. Alright? Your previous relationship that you have your familiarity trap.
You know, it is really hard to draw a line. Sometimes you don't feel it so hard until you put yourself in that position. Okay. Just imagine this. Let's say I'm a woman and I'm married to you. Okay? We are husband and wife. Now we divorce. Ex-husband. Staying in my same house. And now I marry a new husband. Join me in the same house. In the same house, ex-husband to present husband. How is he going to deal with me when we used to be so close? When, you know, we are husband and wife, he has seen everything about me, I've seen everything about her, but the question is now we are no longer husband and wife. How are you going to draw the line? You think it's easy? You know, he probably will still behave as though I'm still his wife. See, it's not going to be easy because that old relationship has messed up everything. So if you still want to come back, you're coming back as a chairman. You're not coming back as a CEO. But will you still behave like a chairman or will you still think that you're a CEO? How are you going to draw that line? Very hard, right? So it's not so easy.
And the best way is what? Avoid it. You know, since it's going to be problematic, avoid it. Because not everything is going to be easy, so avoid it now. So that's why you're going to see that there'll be a lot of confusion in their role. Confusion in the role, confusion in the authority. You know, a lot of people will get so confused.
So if these guys start telling me something, do you think the staff will look at him and say, you know, he's my ex-boss, or he's still my boss? It's not easy, right? So that's one problem, okay?
Now, number three, you might even become overprotective of your old decision when you were the CEO.
Overprotective of your old decision. Because these are what you decided in the past. But not everything about my idea is great. Now, you know, the fact that you say we still want to think about having a third national car company, I think that's nonsense. We cannot have national car because we are very small. That's it, full stop. We only have 30 million people. How many people you want to sell the car to? How fast can your car come up with new model? Look at Toyota, they sell to the whole world. Half of the world buy Toyota. So they have enough money to make the car and they have enough money to innovate. Malaysia? You just can't. There are times that you've got to admit that you're just not big enough to do certain things. So the pride is not there. So don't do it now. So I don't like that. So you say that we should think about the car. I think that's stupid. Wait until Malaysia got another 100 million people, maybe you can do so. See that? He come back again as a prime minister and he want to do back again the old thing. That's human nature, protective of what you do because you feel that this is my prime. Now, so all CEO, when you retire, you come back, you're going to have that problem. You're going to say, oh, this one, why you never do? Then they start to fight. Remember when Mahathir, I don't think you know, when Mahathir stepped down, Abdullah Badawi cancelled a lot of his project. Actually, Abdullah was quite a nice prime minister. A lot of people don't like him because he sleep a lot. But he's a nice minister because he didn't do a lot of things. The fact that he don't do a lot of things, the country got no problem. When you start doing all the nonsense, the problem all come. That's why when he came in, he stopped all the project by Mahathir. Mahathir was very angry. So Mahathir write about him. And that's why writing is so powerful. He go and write in his blog and always criticize him. And that time he managed to kick him down and change to Najib. But Najib, he write no use. Because Najib is worse than Abdullah. Abdullah, nature is very soft. He very softened. That's why when you talk, he cannot take it. Okay, I step down. Najib, no, thick face, man. You don't feel me? Very thick, right? His face, all right? Now, so this is the problem with coming back
very protective. Now, and this may actually affect the board unity. A threat to the board unity. Okay, so that's what the code tells us. They say you're not supposed to, but you see the code, very funny. They say, although you're not supposed to, but they say if. Why is there an if? They say if, exceptionally, a board decides that the CEO should become the chairman, the board should consult the major shareholder in advance and set up the reasons to the shareholder at the time of appointment and also in the next annual report. Now, let's think about why is there an if. They say if, exceptionally, you want to do that. That means there must be reason, right? Why do you want to do that? Why?
What makes you think like we want the chairman to come? I mean, we want the CEO to come back as the chairman. Like, why that Tay Hong Piao, when he stopped as a CEO, he came back as the chairman? Anyone knows what's the reason? Corruption? No. Because he is the owner of the bank. I'm a shareholder. I'm a shareholder. So I want to come back and I put my name up and I vote. And I hold so many shares. Huge percentage. When I say yes, who can say no? So really, you don't have a choice. Right? So one reason is because I'm the shareholder. Alright?
He is the shareholder. That's why you see they say
you should ask the shareholder in advance. I don't need to ask, I ask myself. So I go to the mirror and say, hey, I become chairman, okay? The mirror says, okay. I come back. So I have the power.
Now, but this could be another reason. But what are the more valid reasons?
Competent in what way?
Skills.
Who? Who is the competency that you're talking about? Now, why do you say that competency is a problem? I have stepped down as a CEO, and you think I'm a very good CEO, but now I'm not a CEO, I'm a chairman. How did the CEO and the chairman still be overlapping? I mean, there's a point there, but how you want to bring it up to Riley completely so that the answer is good? Now, sometimes you can say it's part of transition, which it's a point of competency. The new CEO is so fresh that, you know, he's still not that good. Well, I'm more experienced, so I can stay there and guide you. That's why you see in US presidency, they have this transition period where the old president and the new president will be together, so that the old president will hand over to the new president, and then they have one period that they overlap. But you see, Malaysia don't have one. We don't practice that. That's why once you change everything. But there, they are very concerned about the handover. That's why they have a 6 month period. The old and the new are together. The old will guide the new, and then they teach them how to do the thing. Now that's a very important thing. It's transition. Okay.
And talk about the transition that relate to competency.
So if you highlight transition as a reason, that means this is going to be temporary. It's not for long. Understand? So the chairman will probably be there for the next 6 months or 1 year, and then once the CEO is good enough, he leave. Now,
another good example that I can show you is a case study with Apple. Look at Apple. I just write Apple, so you must understand and
remember what I say. Who was the CEO of Apple? Steve Jobs. And the reason why Apple turned around and revived is because Steve Jobs is so creative. He presents things so well, and his ideas of getting out with all these smartphones and so on.
And people label him as the reason the company is good.
And when he's very sick of cancer, Alright? Everybody been asking, if Steve Jobs is not there, what will happen to the company? You know, it's a big question. Everyone is so worried about it. You know, it's always what we call uncertainty. That's why everybody say, you know, what happened to our country when we change government, right? You know, we keep saying, how is it going to be? We cannot expect because it has not happened. So at that time, all investors are so concerned about if Steve Jobs is not there. Well, true enough, at the very final days of Steve Jobs, he's already not there as CEO because he's so sick that he's already in the hospital. And at that time, Tim Cook is already acting as a CEO. So he has been there running the company like for the past close to, I think, 9 months or 1 year when Steve Jobs is so sick. The very day that they hear Steve Jobs is having a major a problem in his health, that they, you know, doctors say he's probably going to die. What did Apple did? Apple do this. Apple made an announcement and say Steve Jobs resigned as a CEO. But you see, when you say Steve Jobs resigned as a CEO, you're going to give a big blow to the market because everybody say, oh, gone. You know, this is a major issue. So when they announced Steve Jobs resigned, they said, but he remains as the chairman. See the difference? So people feel that, oh yeah, Steve Jobs is still there. At least he's still there to be with the company, but he is not so involved. Now. But the effects is much different. Now, this is a good example of why we wanted the name to be in the company. Because we needed that person. So everybody looked up to him. Now, of course, after they announced that, Steve Jobs still died. The next day, he died. And when he died, but the effects was not so bad. Because when the announcement was made that he resigned as a CEO, and then he become a chairman, more or less, people has understood. They know that his health must have deteriorated so badly already. So people know already. You see, huh? That's why if you go to YouTube, you go and see he made a presentation on iPhone 4. That was the last presentation he did in the conference. It was so thin. No flash. You go and see. But he still come out, see his passion for the company, iPhone 4. That's why when he died, the next model came out was iPhone 4S. And people all ask, why call 4S? In the past, it was never S one. It was called 3, 3G, and 4. Then suddenly it said iPhone 4S. And people speculate the reason is because it's iPhone for Steve. So it's a dedication to him, people say. You know. After that, it's not true because then you got 5S, got 6S, and you know, all the S people. You know, okay? Now, so this is the whole idea of why you needed that person. You want him to be there. Now, another thing that why we wanted the guy to be there is because of his networking. His networking, okay? Have you learned integrated report? Studied this thing before? Integrated report. The six types of capital. Now, I'm just going to write these down. This is the symbol for integrated report. It's always written in that way. So you write like that, people know you're talking about integrated report. Now, we're going to study integrated report like in the next few classes. And one of the things in integrated report is the recognition of capitals. Capitals, alright? And capitals are things you use to generate more return, right? But you see, accountants only look at capital as what? Money. So our capital is the money that you bring in. That's why you have equity capital, loan capital. That's all it. But you don't recognize other type of capital. But when we look at integrated report, they start to recognize capitals like social relationships.
Social relationship
capital. See, I can be a
terribly useless man. Stupid, no brain. Okay? Useless, stupid, no brainer. Completely out. No intellectual. Zero. But I only know how to do one thing. I can make people very happy. And the very, very close person with me is Lim Guan Ming and Mahathir. Enough, huh? I can still make a lot of things in my life, right? By just being close with the Minister of Finance and the Prime Minister, I don't need to have intellectual. They just give me a little bit. Now, if you, I become successful. So do you see that relationship is a capital? Now, and that's the reason why we wanted that person to be there, because you must have got that relationship. You know what happened when you leave? That's why you want to hear a story like people say, "Wow, the father gone already, now the son take over." So a lot of people don't want to deal with them anymore because it's not the father. They wanted to deal with the father, not with the son. Relationship.
So you wanted that because of the relationship. Now, these are why we might want to keep the person. Something for you to ponder. Alright, so again, they say if you want to do that, can get shareholders to agree. Alright, okay, so this is the first part to do with chairman. You see, a little things but a lot of meaning at the back. Now, carry on. Next. Thing must break the ear. Sorry, I always don't know how to break. Okay, we take a short break.
Right. Okay, now we're going to see the next section of the code
addressing the issue of the non-executive director. Now, if you look at actually section A4 and then section B1, they are actually a continuation. Now let me just give an overview of what is A4 and B1. Now A4, they tell you about the NED, but when you go to B1, they start telling you about the composition of the board. And when you see the composition of the board, they start to tell you like how many directors that you need to be independent.
See, it says here in B1.2 that unless you're a smaller company, at least half of the board, excluding the chairman, must be non-executive directors determined by the board to be independent. Now, excluding chairman, that's because the chairman is supposed to be independent.
Make sense or not? So if the chairman is supposed to be independent, they say excluding the chairman, half of the board must be independent. So if I just use a simple way of illustrating, so if you have a board with 9 people, this is the chairman, and he's supposed to be independent. So you left with what? 8, right? So in the 8 people, how that the composition has to be? 4 independent NED, and another 4, they are not independent. Now, not independent, not necessarily ED. You can have example like 1 a non-independent NED and 3 ED, they are still not independent, right? Now, but the idea is this independent director always has the controlling power because it's 5 against 4. The whole idea is very simple, right? They want the controlling power in the board. Whenever you call for voting, the power is in the hands of the non-independent director and not in the hand of the non-independent. And I've told you this is because, remember when we first start talking about delegation of power? Where did I talk about that? and I've told you about delegation of power. The reason why we have to make it in that way is because the management has the power at the low level, which is in the hand of the ED. So it only makes sense to give the next power to the NED so that there's a balance of the power. So that was the reason why when we wanted the structure, we want to do it in that way. So a more significant public company, that means a company that is really big, when the market capitalization is really big, you realize that this number here grows larger and larger. So please don't be surprised to see a company that they can tell you, we may have 9 independent directors against 4. Well, of course, when you do that, the problem is you're gonna pay them. As I said, independent directors are not here for free. So if each director, you just imagine if you get one additional director and you're gonna pay this director additional 60,000. You're supposed to have 5, but you get additional 4. So 4 times 6 is 240,000 to the company. So if the company's profit is only like 1 or 2 million, then shareholder will start questioning what is the sense behind. But you see, companies like Apple, $1 trillion company. You can't afford to have these other companies to fail. So that's the reason why shareholders would insist to have more independent directors to protect them. And when they actually have independent directors to protect them, some larger investor even request to have their own appointees. Okay, example in Malaysia, like EPF. When EPF invests a lot, right, in your company, EPF would actually wanted somebody that EPF trusted to sit in the board. So that EPF will feel safer that, you know, at least we know what's happening in the board because we have a director from us. That's what they do. Understand? Now, so look back into this idea. So we can see the intention of the code is like this. The management layer is already controlled and under the influence of the CEO. And that's where the ED comes in. Now we told you a lot about the chairman, and we say the chairman is a really important guy to make sure that you protect the interests of the shareholders. But the chairman is useless if he does not have the power. And the only way that chairman derives his power is the power or the authority to make decision, which is collectively when you add in the NED. So that's how the power comes in. So if you look at the logic of how they arrange the code, it makes sense, right? They started off by telling you the board, then they tell you about the chairman, and now they tell you about the NED. So that the NED go and join the chairman. That's how the code is being structured, okay? So I hope they give you a clearer understanding of what the code says. Now, so we're gonna go through these two parts now. Now it says that, as part of the role of members of a unitary board. Now, I've told you about unitary board before, right? What's a unitary board? Means what? ED and NED sit together. That's a unitary board, okay? So ED and NED sit together. Now, and because UK uses a unitary board structure, that's why the code is meant to be a unitary board structure. Now it says that as part of a unitary board, right, the NED should, now this whole section talks about the role of NED. This part, if you read, right, when you read this, then you learn about the role of NED. What NED is supposed to do? What chairman is supposed to do? Remember, how many? Look at me. How many role chairman is supposed to do? 6. That's what the code says. leadership, set agenda, constructive relation, ED and ED contribution, accurate, clear, timely information, and shareholders communication. See, you must remember all that on your own. Okay? So please don't study. Everything makes sense when I explain because it's logical. But remembering and logical is two different things. You don't remember, you can't do it. Please. Okay? Now we're going to start seeing the role of NED. So what does NED do? Okay. Can I read through the whole thing and then I highlight to you? It says that, now, non-executive directors should constructively challenge and help develop proposals on strategy. Non-executive directors should scrutinize performance of management in meeting agreed goals and objectives and monitor the reporting of performance. They should satisfy themselves on the integrity of the financial information and that financial control and systems of risk management are robust and defensible. They are responsible for determining appropriate levels of remunerations of the executive directors, and they have a prime role in appointing and, where necessary, removing executive directors and succession planning. Now, that's what the quote says, and I'm going to summarize it with four words. SSPR. The first S is this: strategy. The second S is this: scrutinize. Well, the P means things to do with people. Alright? Things to do with human resources. So can you see in this paragraph what are the things to do with people? I'm going to ask yourself. Can you assign two columns for me? 7, 9, because I didn't give you the last week. Then that's the MD one. What's the P? Where is the P? Which part of the paragraph talks about people? Sorry? Yeah, the staff remuneration, the salary that you give to directors, and removing directors, appointing directors, succession planning. That's all to do with people. Alright, now, and what is the R? Anyone know what's the R? If you guess the word, what is the R? It's all there. If you see the paragraph, you can pick this word R. What is left? Reporting. Okay, now actually, besides reporting, it talks about risk management. So the R is to do with risk. It's about the systems of internal control. It's about it's about the risk, the internal control. So that's the R, okay? Now, so let's just go deeper and try to understand what does the R means, the risk role, okay? Now, I'm not sure if you realize that, but generally, all the role that we say about NED, right, they are actually discharged through the individual committee. Now, how many committees that we have in a board, based on what you study, remember? What are the key committees? AC, RC, NC. So I usually tell the student NAR, okay? So the nomination, audit, remuneration. Now this simple testing, huh? Do you remember what kind of members do you need when you're talking about nomination? What is the requirement? Net, yeah. How many net? All net, half net, all net. Is nomination all net? No. Majority net, not all, majority. So the code says if you are nomination, you need majority. Now, when you say net, be careful. It's not just net, but it's independent. So you need majority independent director. Now, majority, independent, NED. What about ACRC? All independent, NED. So do you see the point that basically the committees are just made up of independent directors? So whatever the committees are doing, It reflects what the independent directors are doing. So what do you do in remuneration committee? Setting remuneration. You set the remuneration for the ED. Now that's why they say the independent director's role is to decide remunerations. And that's reflected in the RC. Okay? But the RC is made up of independent entity. So it's the same thing if you look at it. Now, and you look at it that they mention about things like appointing, removing, succession planning. Which committee handles that? Nomination. Yeah, that's the human resource committee. That's a nomination. And who deals with things like scrutinize, performance, financial information, internal control, risk management? Who does that? Audit. It's handled by audit. All right. Now, in fact, if they say, what about strategy? Now, you can also say strategy is part of audit.
That's why every time when they have any major decisions that they want to go through, it goes through audit committee. The AC will start here. Now, and collectively in the board, the independent director will actually be there to listen again. So it's still part of the independent director.
Now, this is what they say. So what do you do when you talk about strategy? Now, there are two things that they say here about strategy. They say, one, you challenge. Two, you develop proposal. How do you challenge? You question the viability of a strategy. That's your job. Because every strategy has money. Okay? You do something and you gotta have money. Now you see, like, if you read the AG report, right? The AG report says that the government built two marinas.
I can't remember which shore that they did. It was a marina. The place where they park all the ship, the luxury yacht. But you know, in Langkawi had a lot of marina. Where all the luxury yacht. How luxury a yacht can be is you look at the picture now, they forward about this. I can't even know how to pronounce the name. Then the Jolo one. If you see the picture, you're like, wow, so beautiful. Real feel like scolding. Okay? Now, but don't worry, we pray that the government will open up and let us go in and stay there. Because all the Malaysians contributed to the job, so we should go in and stay there once a night. Okay? So Malaysia registered the name. Okay? Now, so you see, all these are the things they do. They build two marina and they spend millions. And what did they do in the marina? Never operate. They build everything, then they stop that. You read newspaper, that's what they say.
See, the government are a steward to the people, just like a company. You handle resources, you go into strategy, but the question is, every time you do something, viable or not? I mean, why do you do something that at the end there's no return? That's the problem. So all business is the same. So if you want to go into a business venture, the NED must take a step back and ask and see, can make money or not? I mean, cannot make money, what's the point of us doing it? That's challenge. Challenge. Okay? So when you challenge, you need to be able to throw them with question. Like, show me the numbers. You know, do you have a projection? And then, how reasonable are your assumptions? Give them the what if. You know, what if you have this problem and you don't have a solution? What if there's no manpower? What if the resources are going to go up in price? What if all that? Have you think about all that? That's your job. NED's job. You throw questions. If I throw questions, they cannot answer. What are you going to do? That's very important. Now, I remember Mr. Yap. But once he had a friend ask him about a proposal to open up a shop in Jalan Ipoh to sell curry laksa or sell wantan mee. Hey, this young man, very enterprising, came out with a booklet of survey report with nice picture and write up and say that how his business is going to be and how he find that he's going to be successful. So I remember Mr. Yap came to me and asked me my opinion. I go through, the next thing I say, sure fail one. Now see, my view is sure fail. Now because I'm looking from an angle of a lot of questions, see, I throw a lot of questions, I say, you go and ask your friend all these things about why that thing will not work out. Now, but later on, the friend insisted, they started. They went ahead, they start, maybe because they felt that, you see, a lot of things is emotion. They felt that, yes, it workable. They start, after a few months, they fail. My friend also started a business when I was in Petaling Street those days. I saw my friend started one shop next door, something like a pub kind of cafe. I don't know what you call that. Inside got some snooker table, and then people sit down, they can order beer and drink. And then my friend said, it's going to be a brilliant idea, because Petaling Street, you know, tourist center, a lot of people come, and then they can get this premium market, invested 300,000, less than 6 months, closed down, all money gone. 300,000, so simple, huh? Yes, you know? Now that's why you see, you throw question and ask them, think about all that, that's your job. Until they satisfy you, you should say no. So you vote and say, no, we're not going to go ahead. Why? You cannot convince me. That's your duty. Well, you don't just go there and say challenge. You can actually bring in ideas also. You know, as independent director, there's a lot of things you see that's not to do with the business, right? Because you're not there, man. You can go holiday and you saw a model and hey, this thing I never think of. You come back and tell your company, hey, why don't you all do this? Oh yeah, that's a good idea. So you help them with strategy. So simple things, right? Strategy. Now, you are there to keep an eye that scrutinizes. Keep an eye on what executives are doing. So when you say scrutinize, you start looking at things like what? You start to look at things like, do they have any overspend, abuse of power, okay? Conflict of interest, agency problem. It's your report card. Looking at the report card, okay? Now, of course, then you look at their financial information, the control, the risk. Now, what you do here is you want to make sure that the systems are in place. So that's your job. Make sure that the systems are in place.
Because sometimes it's small problem that leads to big problem. And actually, you'd be so surprised that all the big problems that we see in our history all fall back to one small little thing: human attitude. It's always that simple. It's not because we're stupid, it's not because we're not able to have better ideas, it's because of our attitude. Now, you know BP oil crisis, deep water crisis, heard of this? BP. Deep water crisis. They dig oil from the seabed, okay? That's the pipe where they suck out the oil. There's an explosion at the valve. So the thing got disconnected and the oil started to leak out to the sea. This crisis has caused them multi-billion of losses. And when they investigate, reasons behind the crisis included they didn't change the battery that is supposed to be a control, that if anything goes wrong, the thing will activate. And when the thing activates, it will act as something to stop the crisis. And there's an alarm that will actually set off to tell people you're in danger. Simple thing like that. Battery. How expensive will it be to change battery? Compare the cost of changing battery with the multiple billion of losses. And how many people die? And what's the real cost? It's attitude. It's all back to human. And attitude is all back to culture. So a lot of things are so simple. It's not a big mega things behind a mystery. It's stupid reason, but still we repeat our problem. Okay. Now we see that sometimes in the future, if I do research with you, I'll probably bring it up and show you. Now, so it's us that is responsible to make sure that the systems are in place, to have the checks so that all these things are catered for. That then, of course, when you say your role as the nomination committee, you need to go get candidates, appointment to get candidates. If you find that they're not good, you kick them out. You know, you don't keep people that they're liability to the business. And then you got to in charge of succession planning. So all these are quite straightforward. Now let's look at what the code says about this, the provision. Now, 4.1. It says, the board should appoint one of the independent NED to be the senior independent director. Now, this is not really saying that you're more senior. It's just a position. It's just a position. So you see, not normally in the list of independent director, you already have a chairman. All right? Now, some companies, they have more independent directors. So what they do, right, they have a deputy chairman. They get one more, they have a deputy chairman, all right? Now, and then what happened is, you must, because it's a code requirement, the code says you must do that. So get another person and call this person senior independent director. Just give him a title. Why must you give this person a title? Because we want to tell shareholder that if you have problem with the company, speak to the chairman. You speak to the chairman, if the chairman is not acting on your concern, now try speak to the senior independent director. So it's like the second person for you to go to. That's all. So imagine that I'm telling you the college, you have any problem with this, you say speak to me. But you speak to me, no action is happening. So how? That's it. Okay, speak to Miss Christina. Just another person. So we're giving shareholder alternative. Because maybe you don't feel nice to talk to the chairman. Now, that's why if you read the code, they say, the reason is because you want to give a sounding board. The board is more sound. okay, sounding board for the chairman and serve as an intermediary for other directors when necessary. The SID should be available to the shareholder if they have concerns, which the contact through the normal channels of the chairman or the CEO or other directors has failed to resolve the problem. See that? Back up, that's all. Okay?
Now go to the next page. Chairman must hold meetings with the NED, without the ED. Now, and if you think and see, link this back to the one we said just now, the effective contribution of your NED. So I just put down the page first. Link back to page 53, A3, effective contribution of NED. Now I hope you remember why that is good, because when you meet up with them, then you actually see how well they prepared. And if they, in case they didn't prepare, you're able to brief them and so on. Now, and then they say, now it's a different requirement. Then they say, led by the SID, now the NED will meet without the chairman. You see,
we are all director. Okay, we are all director. So it is really hard for you to be at such a senior position to have check and balance because you're so powerful. And there are a lot of times people that not tell you your problem because of your position. Just like, for example, you look at our politics now. You know, Mahathir is the prime minister, and a lot of people say, you know, I can't come in here and say, hey Mahathir, you know what? See, a lot of people might feel worried because his position, his authority, but if we made it a requirement, so what they do is they should just come up a policy for the country and say 5 ministers will meet once a year to discuss about how well the prime minister has performed, and then come up with a report and then tell him. Would that be good? That's good, right? Because if you need somebody to come today and say that, you know, you're not doing the right thing. But the question is, who is doing that? So you always assume you are the best person just because you are the most senior person. That's why Najib always tell the country got no problem. You know, until the day that he lost the government, he still don't believe he lost. Because when he's up there, everybody telling the country is going on fine. This is like CEO walk around the office and all the employees come. And the CEO said, everything is doing well. I'm happy. Staff are happy. But he didn't know once you leave, turn back, people start criticizing the company. That's what he didn't hear. Now, this is how you solve the problem. Have another guy meet up and talk about you and report and tell you. You know, that's your problem. See that? It's cross-checking. It's a very, very useful system. And you do it. Mean it, okay? Now, so they say when you have this SID and NED to meet up, you are trying to appraise the chairman. So you tell the chairman, you're not doing your job, you see? Now, that's very important. So you see, the code is really useful, but the problem is, are people serious about implementing? If companies really implement all that, they will really working wonders on you. Okay? Now,
then it goes on and says that where directors have concern that they cannot resolve, right? They have to make sure that the concerns are recorded in the board minute, and on resignation, the NED must give a written statement to the chairman to circulate. Now, can I give you a background story of what is this and why is this needed? Okay? Okay, remember when we talk about unitary board, we said to you, NED is just director. I said that right? And the liability as NED is the same liability as any ED. You're just director. Okay? Now, because you're just director, we said that you're equally accountable as any other director. Equally accountable. So if I can put ED to jail, I can put NED to jail also. No problem, okay? Malaysia, first case where NED being jailed is a case called Transmile. You can Google Transmile. T-R-A-N-S-M-I Transmile, M-I-L-L-E, I think. There's also a fraud, a scandal goes on. Alright? Malaysia is a very powerful country. We have more scandals, bigger scandals, than those scandals out there in the Western world. Right? But all our scandals never kill us. We die hard. Okay? Now, so you see, the thing is, that's the first case in Malaysian history that the independent director was sent to jail. The Siena. Because the independent director don't know anything, don't know what's happening, but it's stupidly ambiguous. I know, I see the figure, oh okay, no problem, they signed the report. So when the thing happened, they got caught, then they asked the independent director, why did you sign? I thought I told you. So it's the first case that directors went to jail being independent directors, okay? Then the CEO living happy ever life with all the money. This is really no justice, man, because you know? So when you're equally accountable, understand this, you are actually more risky. So NED is more risky than ED. I've told you that, right? Can you repeat again what's the reason? Why that being NED you're more risky? I've said the reason to you the last time. Because of what? Anyone remember? Because? Yes, you are not involved in day-to-day operation. So a lot of things you don't know. A lot of things you don't know. So it's really easy sometimes for you to cheat, to hide things from the NED, to don't tell them all the story, and they might be believing that things are going on well. So NEDs are more risky because of that. So remember, the lack of information
is the reason why things are more risky for you. So now look at this.
If you become an independent director, right, you are NED, and knowing that there are more risk becoming ED, should you do something to protect yourself? You need to, right? But the question is, what can you do? How do you protect yourself? Now, there are a few things you must do to protect yourself. So, NED must protect yourself from these dangers.
Number one, whenever you go into a meeting and you are not happy with something, you raise it up. That's why it says here in 4.3, alright?
If you have anything that you're not happy, concerns that you cannot resolve, that means you are not happy, you raise it up, right? And still nobody acted on it.
You have to make sure that your concerns are recorded in the minutes. That means the minutes must say, Mr. Lau, the chairman of the AC, opposed to the idea. He said blah 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 blah. But you see a name is there and it's all written down. Now my next question is, how do you know the ComSec write it down? That's what the quote says. It says make sure that it's recorded in the meeting. You know, every meeting must have meetings, right? To record things that you discuss. But the next thing is be practical. How do you make sure that it's recorded now? What do you do
to be sure that they record down. Now we're testing very simple thing. You do all that every time when you have meetings. If you don't do, means you're not having meeting in the right way. Sorry? Keep record, yeah, you keep record, yes. The concept is there to write down what you want to discuss. But the next thing, how do you make sure that they record it? I mean, the concept is sit down and write only what you. Okay, yeah. Then do you go and play back? So what is the more likely thing that you're going to do? Foul. Yeah, fouling them. You confirm minutes. Do you realize that? Do you know that? Every meeting starts with confirmation of the minutes of the last meeting. That's the procedure. I'm not sure if you do that in club. Do you do that in club? No, now you must do it. So I'm telling you, this is the right procedure of having meetings. The right procedure of having meeting is you must have agenda before you meet, and the first agenda is to confirm the meeting that you discussed the last meeting. So that's why you will send out the minutes of the last meeting together with all the agenda and all the paper, and all the director will go through. And you raise an issue, right? You have to read it and say, hey, I remember I opposed this idea. Why my name was not there? And you ask. That's how you make sure. So you say, you can ask the comsec the next meeting, why my name was not recorded? You insist. Put my name there. Don't go out. I don't sign. I will sign the minutes to confirm that the minutes is real. I don't sign. When I don't sign, you cannot foul, you see. There's a fouling requirement by the law. So see that? That's the process that we actually go through. So that is what you do. So that's why they say,
you got to make sure that the concerns are recorded. Think about that. How? Through confirmation of minutes. That's what directors got to do.
Now, and then look at this. By raising an issue, okay, that you tell people that you're not happy with this and so on, it's not enough. If you kept on raising the issue, and yet no action is taken. So how? If you keep complaining about something and yet nobody seems to care about what you complain, what are you going to do? You resign. You leave. Leaving is a way of protesting. To show that, sorry, we are not one gang, I cannot go on with you. You resign. That's what the court says. After this statement, we say on resignation. That means they skip the few lines because they expect you understand. You complain, nobody do anything, please resign. Resignation is the best way for you to wash your hand from the problem. And that's what Najib is trying to do. He resigned. He didn't resign, he cannot sack up. But of course, you must understand that you resign at a certain point. We still can go back to that point, you're still like that. But a resignation is the best way to show you're not happy with something. And the best thing is when you resign, what must you do? You must give reason. And that's the problem with Malaysian culture. In school, were you taught how to write resign letter? No. You only taught how to write application letter. How to apply a job. Never teach you how to resign. Alright now? Why? Expect you work and then die with the company. Don't resign. See, we never teach how to handle the ending. You're taught how to handle the beginning. So that's why you always don't know how to end one. The ending is always gone. I say all the relationship in the office, all like that one. When it comes to resignation, everything turns so ugly. Quarrel, fight, not happy, grudge, from friends become enemy. Why? Don't know how to handle resignation. That's why a lot of people when they resign, they don't tell the truth. Why you resign? You're not happy with the guy. You can say, I resign for what? I hate you. The way you do things, so terribly annoying. You can say that. But you say, personal reason. See, you always hide and you don't tell the truth. So that's the problem. That's why now we're telling you, directors, you know, when you resign, be honest with the reason.
Why? If anything happened to the company, when we dig back the old case, we go back and we say that, oh, this was the time you, director, now we call you back for questioning. Why you never raised the issue when the company had this problem? Oh, yeah, I resigned. Well. So they check back the record. Then you resign and say, reason is because personal issue. No, you're not having a problem. But if you write that, the reason I resigned because I'm not happy with this thing, how it was developed, and then I complain, I oppose this, but no action is taken. That's a protection. And then when you want to send directors to jail, you don't need to go jail. See, I oppose one. But I oppose useless because the company got 7 directors. I alone say no. The 6 people all say yes. But I'm not wrong, you know. I have done my part. Now, that is a very important protection. So one thing, you raise concern. That's what they say. Raise concern and you record it. Then when you resign, you must give a reason. Record. Reason. Now, can I add one more that should be the thing? You must ask question. Don't be a director that you're there keeping quiet. You gotta ask question. Okay? That's how you protect yourself as director. Now, let's just come down and see this. Okay, now we know the role of NED is there to SSPR for shareholder. And now they tell you about how the board is supposed to be. So they say that the board and the committee must have the right balance. Okay? Now that's a very important thing, having the right balance. Alright, now, and when you say you need the right balance, you always got to say balance of what? I mean, what kind of balance that you're saying? Now, I'll summarize this later. Let's just read the whole thing first. It says that balance of skills, experience,
independence, knowledge, so the company can, of the company, so that they can discharge their duties. And then it goes on, the board should be of sufficient size so that the requirement of the business can be met and that changes to the board's composition
and its committee can be managed without undue disruption. They should not be so large to be unwieldy. The board should consider appropriate combination of executive and non-executive directors, especially the independent NED, so that no individual or small group of directors can dominate the decision taking. And it goes on and says that the value of ensuring memberships is refreshed and undue reliance is not placed on a particular individual should be taken into account when you determine the chairman and the memberships of the committees. And no one other than committee chairman and the members are entitled to be present at the committee meetings. But you may invite others if you want, okay? Now, these are the principle, then it comes to the code. Now, so from here, it tells us a few types of balance. So whenever we talk about board balance, we think of balance of what? Like the first one, they say skills, knowledge, experience. See that? Now, skills, knowledge, experience. You know, you need people that is good in different things. Okay? You see now they get a very education background minister of education, the Masjid. Last time they have a very political background. So a political background screw things up because it's too political. Now you have very education also screw things up because they are not enough political. See, the balance is not there. Look at what they say about UEC. Remember his reply? They are talking about should student study from UEC be given recognition to go into public U. And before the election, Pakatan Harapan said, when we win, we recognize that. And now what does the Datuk Masri say? Give us 5 years to survey. You must be crazy. 5 years to survey. Hello, do you talk rightly or not? What do you need to do? 5 years, if my wife is pregnant and my son enter kindergarten. Correct or not? You say you want 1 year, 2 years, understand? 5 years is a crazy man talking. See, that's the problem. So a person who doesn't have the right blend of skills, screw up things, okay? So very sad. One. Now, what other balance do you see? Can I have your point? What other balance do you need besides skills and skills?
Faster, time is running out, faster.
Yeah. Yeah, balance of the director. The size, we say balance of size. The number of directors. What else? The G plan. The G plan. What other talents do you have? That's more talents. Besides the sign, if you can look at the background of building, tell me so clearly what other things that you need to balance. Authority. Very hard for me to put it up, although I try to accept the answer. Not bad. Other things? Balance of independent director. Okay. Balance of independent director. Now the size is the number of director. The independent is the number of independent director over the non-independent. So we're talking about the ratio. Okay, the number two is the size, the next one is the ratio. Now I think we actually have something here that if you go down, right? Page 55. Sorry, I got to skip because I want to tell you, okay? If you go down to page 55, you can see under the supporting principle, it says that the search for the board candidate should be conducted and appointed based on merit against objective criteria with due regard for the benefits of diversity, including gender. Now, so actually when you talk about the board balance, right, we even include balance of diversity. We take that into account. Okay, now every balance is needed for some reason. And they are quite obvious, like skills and knowledge is quite obvious, right? Okay. Why is balance of size important? Now, too big versus too small. What will happen when you have a board that is too small? Not enough director, what will happen? Company, not enough staff. What will happen to the staff? Duty cannot complete. He's telling me it's things in the heart, alright? Now, you overwork the staff. Okay, you overwork the staff. And of course, when the staff overwork, you cannot deliver, right? Your results affected, no? So the effectiveness drop. Okay, effectiveness drop. Now, you know, sometimes because your body is so small, you may actually have a problem with one person wear a few hats. We call this multiple portfolio. You are in charge with a few things. You know, when you start in charge with a few things, what will happen? Power. That's where the assignment of authority, but it's quite far lah, huh? But power comes in. You give too much power to one person. Not enough people, okay? Now, what if you have too many directors? What's the main issue with too many directors? Ashtosh, what's the problem when you have too many directors? Sorry? Yeah, decision will take longer time, okay? You actually slow down the decision. A slower decision-making process. Now, that's the problem with a unitary board. Remember, I told you, a multi-tier board is faster, is swift in reacting. You're going to be slow. Now, and I told you just now, right, every director means cost. They're not working for free, you know. So when you have big directors, you end up with what? Heavy cost. That's the problem we had in Malaysia in the old government. We are the country, the one country in the world that has the highest ratio of public servant to the citizen. We only have 30 million people. How many million working with the government? If you say 5 million, let's say, that means your ratio is 1 to 6. That means you must be very proud, you know. Every one of you got six garment, sorry, every six of us got one garment servant stand beside us to be with us all the time. That's ridiculous, right? Now, of course, why the government is doing that? Because those days they thought that when I get garment servant, they vote me. That's why the government wanted the garment servant. But it's inefficient, too big. The cost is very high, okay? Now, that's why there's always the issue of cost. Now, size. What is the code's intention? So can I mark it down for you with a star? Okay, go up, man. Go up, go up. Now, up, 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 up here. Okay, they say sufficient size. See that? So that the composition can be managed without disruption. Example, if you got director resign or you got director leave, okay, you don't have to worry because there's someone there standby. Alright, now understand the point, huh? Now they also say, please don't have a very large board because it shouldn't be so large to be unwieldy. Unwieldy means hard to control. That's unwieldy. You want to know what's hard to control? Just imagine you're going to organize a tour, a shopping tour, go to one utama, and you're going to bring the kindergarten boys or the kids. You are one teacher, you bring 30 kids, go bring them shopping and see. Now you will know what is called unwieldy, too big already. You see, you know? Now one handle 10 is already headache. You can't handle 30, so that's unwieldy, hard to control. All right. Now, and then if you come down, they say the value in making sure committee membership is refreshed. Can I know what do you mean by refresh? What is fresh? What's the opposite of fresh? Stale or not fresh? You know, I always ask you, what's the opposite of fresh and not fresh? Okay? Now, when something is fresh and stale or dull,
or boring. Okay? The Chinese got one very nice word called sincere guy. You feel fresh. What is feeling fresh? Ask those couple, just together one. What is the feeling? That's called fresh. Ask again the couple after 2-3 years. What is the feeling? That's called not fresh. What happened when they're not fresh? Have you ever got this question from your mom ask you, like, what do you want to eat for dinner? And she said that, you know, I don't know what to cook for you anymore. Or you go home and you tell your mom, wow, this again. Gone, huh? Never. Your mom never asked this question. That means your mom never cook. If your mom cooks, sure, she asks one. Because you always eat the same thing and again and again and again until you feel so boring on the food. Sometimes you complain to your mom, then your mom asks you, you tell me what you want to eat. And you don't know what to tell. Now, you realize that is a situation where your mom has become boring. And when somebody becomes boring of the job, what will happen? No creativity, no fresh feeling, 没有新鲜感, no fresh feeling, boring, dull, ineffective, no results. So she cook until she don't need to see the walk. She still can cook one. She can watch movie while cooking also. Because she even put the hand on it, she knows where is the salt, where is the pepper. Because she is born. Now, how do you make things different? To create new excitement. So that when you eat the food, the feeling is so different than what do you do? One, you change your mind. Don't get her to cook, get other people to cook. That's why men like that, after they bought with the girlfriend, they change girlfriend. Right? No. Okay? So they feel like, oh, I need a new excitement, so I change a new girl. That's the problem. That they believe that changing faces is how you bring excitement. That's why it's really true that at different stage of life, you need to introduce excitement so that you don't feel down. And one way is what? Rotate the responsibility. Change it. You know, you don't do the same thing. That's why sometimes it's good that you say, let the father do the cooking. And then you complain. They say, no. Or you do the cooking. Right? Then you try. They say, no. Now, so refreshing could be through one, you change the people through rotating their job, or you give them new skill. Tell your mom, hey, why don't you try Italian food? Russian food, French food, I don't know what. I pay money, you go and learn. You do that. Well, then every week you come home, it's a new type of dish. Wow, the excitement in the family. Can you see, you know? Skill. Apply the same concept in company. It's the same. You get the same guy to do the same thing again and again, again and again. What will happen to the results? No results. So that's why the quote say, ask yourself, we put value to make sure that you refresh the people. How do you refresh the people? Don't let the same guy do the same job. But think and see, if you don't have enough director, how are you going to do that? Your board only got 3 director. Doremi, Doremi, no matter how you change, it's still Doremi. You can't change. So you need new people, more people. Do you see that? Now, that is why the size is important. Hope you get the idea, okay? Now, that's because we already say we need the balance of power. So we need enough number of independent director. Okay, diversity. Now, what is diversity? Rojak. Malaysia word, rojak, one word, enough already, understand everything, okay? You understand diversity because you understand we are Malaysian. Diversity means when you go and order drink, you don't order only teh peng. You can order teh cham kopi, you can order teh cham milo, you can order teh cham milo cham kopi, you can order 3 color layer teh. You see, only Malaysia got all that because we have diversity. You go US, you cannot order things like that one. They only know tea is tea,
coffee is coffee. Cannot chum here, chum there. You know? Now, that is called diversity. Now, what is the good thing of being diverse? So that's why they always stress about example. You can have diversity in terms of age. Don't just have all director become the old people. Try some young people and see. That's why I tell you honestly, this time the Pakatan government is nicer because you got more young people becoming ministers. You know, young people don't think like old people, but too many young people also dying. That's why we have young people. We're very good. We have a minister as old as 94 years old, as young as 20 something. We are the best in the world. No one can beat Malaysia. Malaysia is the most famous country now. We are so diverse. Very old, very young. Age diversity. Now we talk about gender diversity. Have men, have women. Now I give you an example. Why diversity is very important. I always show this. Just hold on. I need to find back my notes first. Let's see, where is it? Okay. Can see it? This is a bit hard. Let's see if I... Okay, this one can.
This is the ACCA advertisement in Singapore. Okay? This riot, bling, okay? Bling glamour home. This advertisement is so wrong. Alright? But can anyone, the non-Muslim, tell me what is so wrong about that? I want a non-Muslim to know. Let the guy test the Muslim. The Muslim is looking at him, right? What is so wrong about this picture? Culture, okay, in what way? Yeah, that means they merge the modern culture and the traditional value in Hari Raya, right? And even the way they hip hop. Yo, like that. You know, when people Hari Raya, hey, yo, sir, Hari Raya. You don't do like that, huh? So, okay, there's one thing, culture. But the next thing, even more serious, huh? Didn't wear the song kok, the cover of it. Not that bad, at least they got the hat there, okay? One more. You shouldn't tell me. You Muslim, what? But you can't tell. He saw the point. You say also the point. But the rest didn't see the point because you say, huh? Got problem with that? You see, obviously Chinese won't understand that. But I understand that because I came from a Malay school. I mix Malay and the diversity told me about their culture. That's why those days my friend, they like to wear a jinjian gangster, betul lah. Swasa. I don't know what is swasa in English. Okay. I know it's called swasa. So I always ask them, hey, why do you wear that? Oh, because we cannot wear gold. It's prohibited by our religion. Chinese New Year is what? Huat Ong Heng Chinese New Year. All Chinese talk about money, really. That's why Chinese, when they have New Year, they want gold, red, new. Agree, huh? See? I can almost guarantee you this advertisement is made by the Chinese. That's why put all the people wear all the gold. The men, see? All the gold. The advertisement came out. The next thing was people start to scold IKEA. And I show you what they do. Where is it? Yeah. Hey. Hey. Second paragraph.
Muslim men are forbidden to wear gold. Yet the father and the son are laden with gold. You don't understand our culture. You know? So the guy saying that, you know, it's a misrepresentation of why we celebrate Ramadan and Shawwal. It's not about spending money. It's not about changing things. It's not about showing off. But that's what you portray. You see,
all these are examples of problem that you face just because you don't understand. And all this understanding comes from diversity. So cultural diversity is so important that you don't make blunders.
I remember when P1Y Max, I don't know whether you remember this company or not. That's a stupid company, okay?
Sorry, I every day said people stupid, alright?
Because I remember I had YMAX before, and then they have one last month payment that I paid, but they say I didn't pay. So they still say I owe them money. Not much, only about less than 180. But in principle, I'm paid. So I shouldn't pay, alright? But they say I never pay. So they blacklist my name. So if you go and do a blacklist check, they will have my name blacklisted for owing them more than 5 years never pay. Now 10 years already. That's why if I go and apply bank loan, the bank will ask me, why you owe people never pay? I say you sell one. You think I got no money to pay 100 again? You think I use brain and think. But then bank staff they really follow procedure. They say cannot work, you got blacklist. I say you don't use brain. This is the problem in Malaysia, they don't use brain. If I want to owe people money, I don't want to pay. Will I owe the 90 ringgit? Of course no, right? And 90 ringgit, if I don't want to pay, I drag so long. Do you feel that there's no reason behind it? But they say cannot, I'll lose it. You cannot have blacklist. Okay, swap, then do it essentially. Alright? So don't use brain, people get hard to do it. Now, so this is the problem with culture. So P1Y Max got one advertisement that they like to ask you, sudah potong. Remember? I don't know if you remember that time. All Malaysia, they keep having this advertisement, sudah potong. Potong means cut. Have you cut? Cut what? Cut the line and change to one next. Alright, what are you thinking? The man say cut, you know, the Malay man must cut out, right? And everybody need cut. And then the Malay Muslim ministers, the woman was very upset and say that why do you have advertisements so sexist, so biased? Carry this kind of element. So the very hamsap element. Of course you will say that your heart not hamsap, why would you be hamsap? Of course you can say like that, but at the end of the day, people will still have that kind of so-called culture in your advertisement. Now, all this I can only say is because you're not sensitive enough to women. If you're sensitive enough to women, you don't do this out of blunder. Okay, it's very common. So we need things like age diversity, gender diversity, cultural diversity, and it really helps people to blend together. Okay, now can I refer this page of the notes at the back there to highlight a bit more about diversity? Page 76. Why is a diverse board good? Okay, why is a diverse board good? Now, generally we feel that a diverse board means you get different representatives from different group of stakeholders. Now, think of the two-tier board where employees are given the power to appoint director. Think of that, the two-tier board. So when you have representative of different group,
then the good thing is what? You can have their voices heard because you're able to speak up for them. Because you know, that's why they say it will even help you to get approval from various stakeholder group. You know, that really gets you the corporate citizenship. Now, and it helps you to improve reputation. So you see, I give an example. If your business deals so much with environment, okay, and you know people will criticize you for not taking care of the environment enough, how do you want to shut the mouth of all these people? Now, one of the easier ways is if you're so sure of what you do is right, you're not afraid, right? Invite your opposer. Invite opposer. That means they say, go and get environmental activists. Go and tell them to come. Now, that's why you see now the new government is doing a very good thing. The PAC chairman, they asked Zahid Hamidi, they said they want to propose Zahid. Zahid is the UMNO president of opposition, and PAC chairman is due with check and balance. So they say, what? We want somebody from your side to come in. And in that case, next time, you cannot say that, you know, we're doing all the wrong thing. You are checking. See, that's a good thing. So if my business is a lot of environmental issue, I'm just going to go out and go to this environmental group and say, hello, you're interested or not? Come to my company. I made you independent director. And you know what's happening in my company. So that in the event, if anything goes wrong, you can stand up and say, no, we did the right thing. But you only can do that if you're what? You are good and honest enough. So if you really want to cheat, right, have to do that because you cannot let them know. Understand? So that's why the good thing of diversity is that bring all these people in. Now, and we also understand that diversity is important for compliance issue. Now, in what way the diversity is important for compliance issue? You see, like some country, they needed certain representation, like you see, female representation.
So there are countries that set a ratio, like Malaysia generally in the public sector, right, 30% made up of women at the senior management. Now, do you find this ratio, this practice good or not good? To impose minimum 30% made up of women. Women, what do you feel? Now, the argument is, some women say, why must you set a restriction that you must get 30%? Are you pity us? Women want face on that. You pity us? You think we are not capable? Because you must have 30%, that's why we get a job, is it? I see some women complain and say that. Don't need that one, we still can work our way up. So these are arguments. So that's why some people argue whether this kind of rule is even good or not good. There's always a debate going on. Okay? Now, but anyway, they felt that a blanket discrimination is happening. A discrimination that generally when you work in an organization that they are more masculine, they tend to give chance to the male and they don't give chance to the female. You tend to see that, okay? Now that was why they say one way to solve the problem is set it as a law. People don't have a choice, okay? Now, diversity means you get people from very different background, and that is good to tap into different talent, experiences. It's quite straightforward, right? Okay? Now, and then they say, now, due to point four, you actually have your strategies be more thoroughly debated from different angle. People look at things from very different angles, so it's good. Now, that's some advantages of why
diversity is good. Okay? So I hope I show you enough. Board balance. Different types of balance. Okay? And different reason why the balance is required. Now can we come to page 55? We'll probably see this as the last thing. Okay?
Okay, now what does the quote says about all that? Now B1.1 is the
provisions that touch on directors independent. It says the board should identify in the
annual report each entity that we consider to be independent. The board should determine whether the director is independent in character and judgment.
Now that's, if you remember, F8, this is called independent of mind. Your mind, okay? Independent of mind. Now, and then whether any relationship or circumstances that affects or appear to affect, that's your independent of appearance. There's two types of independent, mind and appearance. Directors also the same.
You must be independent inside as well as outside. The board should state its reason if it determines that the director is independent, notwithstanding the resistance of these relationship or circumstances.
Now, read carefully. They gave you a list of 7 circumstances, okay, that
potentially affects independent of the director. Understand? It affects independent of the director. But they say, if you believe that your director is independent,
even if you have this problem, no problem, tell us. Explain. Just say your reason. That's why they say that you give your reason if you still believe that your director is independent, even though all these reasons exist. So these reasons are what? These are the threats. The threats.
7 of them.
Okay, number 1. The director has been an employee of the company within the last 5 years. Now again, they are just giving you a guide to say 5 years, but we don't apply this strictly, so that's why we must judge. So it doesn't mean that if you're an employee within the last 7 years, you have no problem. Or it doesn't mean if you're an employee for the last 4 years, you do have a problem. Not always. You must judge. But why is this a problem? If you're an ex-employee, what's the issue that you're going to have? Familiarity. Threat. Agree? Because of you being very close to the people.
Familiarity. Now, has had
within the last 3 years a material business relationship with the company, either directly or as a partner, a shareholder, a director, a senior employee with a body that has such a relationship. So business relationship. Now let me just give you a situation for you to ponder on, okay? Now, this guy is the owner, that means the shareholder of X Limited. And X Limited, they have dealing. They sell to A, there is a material business dealing. Now, he comes in, just call him Jack lah. So Jack comes in as a non-executive director. Look at this situation and see what is the problem. Now,
who made this decision?
whether or not to buy from X. Whose authority? Buying from X. Like in this college, I want to buy paper from paper supplier. I want to give contract to people in main aircon. Whose authority? You said any that. Don't be like that. You make me feel like fish, every time I fish, I don't know whether I can fish you or not. Who decide decision like that in the company? Yeah, CEO. CEO can decide, or the CEO can delegate, because this is not a real big decision, right? It's not a decision that you must get the board of directors to come in.
So, chances is, the CEO has power over
this decision. And this decision affects Jack because it's your business. In a relationship like that, when Jack comes in and sits in the board, Jack, CEO, now I need a vote on one particular issue, which a lot of the independent director tell is not the right thing to do. Now I just look at Jack. That's it. What does it mean? Support me and the relationship goes on. You say no, next morning, cancel the contract. Now as Jack, what will you do? You don't have to say no, right? See that?
That's why when you have this kind of dealing, it affects the business, it affects your independence. So I hope you see that as a simple point. Why a business relationship is affecting you, okay? Now, if you receive any additional remuneration, a part of director fee, or when you have share option, or when you have performance-related pay, Now I'm going to change the situation. Now the CEO and you are the AC member. Okay? Now the company has offered you a package that your pay is based on profit. Now the CEO come to you because you are the AC member, you have to approve their account. The CEO come to you and the CEO tell you, we will not impair our bad debt. We will not. Even though the debtors has not paid you for 1 year, you know that it's very hard to get back. But the CEO come and tell you, I think we have confidence of getting back the money, so we don't want to write it off. Now, as a AC chairman, will that be a yes or a no? You know, the right thing to do is a no, to say cannot lah. I mean, the debtor owe you so long, how can you don't write off? You must write off, ma. Now, you might insist on that, right? But now think about this. Because you've been offered a pay that is based on the profit, will you say yes or no?
Yes,
because the profit will go up, then it's good for me. So you see, this is going to be a problem. So that is why they say you should not have anything that is linked to the company's performance. Now the next one is quite easy. They say that if you have a close family ties, so a personal family relationship is affecting you. Now, can I skip the next point? They say, if you're a significant share, why is being shareholder affecting my independence? I thought you say it's good to be a shareholder. So why you say being a shareholder is affecting my independence? Because you be biased to your own interest. Still bad. Example like RPT. Okay? You might just want to buy from your related company. And of course, when you buy from a related company, whatever money comes to you, not all money belongs to you because it is a listed company. So that's a bad thing. Okay? Now, we even think that if you have served in the board for more than 9 years, affects your independence, because by being in the company for so long, what will happen? Close relationship is built. Now, let's look at this one. Across directorship. A crossover. Okay, what is a cross directorship? APLC and BPLC. Now, let's say Jack is in APLC. Okay? And James is in BPLC. So what happened is we invite James to come here as NED. And then what? Jack invited to be NED for B. That's a crossing. A crossover is when I am acting as independent, I'm acting as NED in the board, and you come to my board as NED. Now, how does this affect my independence? This famous Najib's tagline. You help me, I help you. Simple as that, right? So, Jack tell James, you know, come to my board. Whatever I say, agree. So, when I go to your board, whatever you say, I agree. That's it. Now, a cross directorship is not just a cross within two companies. You can cross with many companies. A, B, C, yeah? Okay? Now, let's say Jack, James, and Joseph. And then Joseph comes to A, Jack goes to B, and James goes to C.
It's still a crossing, right? Why? Jack tell James to support Joseph so that Jack support James, then Joseph support me. Fair enough. So you just gonna keep on telling. So that's how you influence. So you tell James, you don't support Joseph, I don't support you. Okay, so James said, okay, I support Joseph. Now then you tell Joseph, for James to support you, you must support me. So we still, you have me, I have you. So the crossing is there.
So that is why all directorship are registered on. You know, when you become a director, right, your name will appear in the government database. That's how the regulation works. Cannot run on. I just do a search, I'll know it. So that is the reason why they know all these politicians. Now the reason why politicians are so easily caught is because they are greedy. And because they are greedy, they don't trust people. If you don't trust people, you do everything using your own name or your relative name. See? You can't. Because everything is registered. If I really want to do a fraud that I don't want people to catch me, I will use Ajit Singh.
No one will know it. Because me and him got no relationship. But I got to bear the risk that if you run away with my money, everything. And now so much money, you then put on a person that's not related to you. That's how all the politicians all end up with one problem. They have no trust. They want to put everything in there. So they are caught.
Now, that's because the systems are all recorded. Very hard to run one. Okay? Now, so all this is the meaning of cross-directorship. Now, if any problem here exists, right? You may not be independent. That's why just now, remember when we study chairman? Where's chairman? Here.
When you appoint a chairman, the chairman must be independent according to the 7 criteria you read through this one. The 7 things. That's what you do. Okay?
Right, so I hope after today you have understood a bit more about things we expect directors to do to protect interests of the shareholder. So I will actually stop here, and then let me just okay, we stop here. I actually wanted to show you the syllabus of what we have covered so far and let you feel that we have progressed. If not, then you say that you talk every time in the class, talk only, like don't know what you learn, okay? But we actually progress. Next time, I'll pass you and show you the syllabus structure that you see, okay? So we finish here and I'll see you next Tuesday.